Welcome, everyone. Third Code 2 replay cast. This time we're going to have a 2v2 on Hamlet. And we're going to have two allied players in the south, JRDN and El Rizitas. I believe JRDN is the one that sent in the replay. And then on the enemy side, we're going to have, of course, in the north spawn, OKW player, Losu88, and Aksa777, or perhaps Aha777, which would be much more fun, and this is what I'm going to refer to him as. Now, Hamlet, of course, pretty wide map. And a very short sort of distance between the two bases. Not a lot of points, just a few strategic points scattered about the map, and two field points in very cut-offable positions, but pretty protectable if you can sort of use the river to your advantage. And the munitions ones are basically right next to the base, but also they have some pretty nasty cut-off positions that both players can use. On the right side of the map, the VP is pretty much not really protected by anything. There's only a little bit of heavy cover. On the left side of the map, there is a little bit of a better spot with this house. And also, if you can manage to, if you're a southern player, get grabbing this building is very, very good. And in the center, there's just a slight bit of light cover and a lot of actually negative cover on both sides due to these patches of water. So you have to be very careful when you're playing on this map to avoid sort of getting into these negative cover areas with the river that are pretty much all the way around the map. And this fog is making me lag a lot. Now, on the right side, we do have Losu, and he's going to go with a pretty standard opening, a cube wagon for him. He's going to go capture the right side of the map of that, and he's actually going to be able to grab the munitions for that, which is going to be really good because OKW is generally pretty short on munitions because they have a lot of things that they have to buy with munitions. So having that extra point is going to help him out in the early game a lot and is going to give him a little bit of an extra munitions lead for later. Now, we do have a mortar from Haha in the left side of the map, and actually two mortars with a machine gun. Machine gun going into the house, actually facing in the wrong way. Should definitely reposition it thanks to the direct face that you can actually do now. Unlike, for example, 3 or 4 months ago, you could not do that. So he should definitely use that feature to his advantage to actually reface the machine gun before it gets into trouble. Of course, the allied players don't really know that the machine gun is there. They just know that there's a mortar. Now, the second mortar is actually going to be shooting at the Soviet position soon enough. Soviets have gone for tier 1 and gotten out two penal squads. Erizdas actually going for the defensive tactics, which are a very interesting commander that is not really picked a lot because it's not exactly the best commander, but it can be fun to play. I'll talk a little bit more about it later. Now, two riflemen, or the two rear echelon squads, facing the Kubelwagen and the Volksgrenadiers. Volksgrenadiers at close range are going to be massacred by the rear echelons. Comparatively to if they had just stayed at long range behind these logs with heavy cover, that would have been much better for them. But at this point, it's a little bit too late to sort of cry over that because the Kubelwagen is still doing fairly well for the Germans, and so it's going to force the rear echelon to retreat along with some reinforcements from the German infantry that have arrived just now. Now, JRDN has decided to go for a second rear echelon squad, which is, in my opinion, not exactly the best decision. Now, on the left side, we do have a bit of an engagement with these pioneers trying to capture the VP and a nice flank from the Pinos. Pinos actually going to be catching the MG off guard and probably forcing it to retreat because they managed to sort of flank it before it could reposition correctly and set up and fire. And probably the MG is going to go down at this point. There's nothing that it can do. Even if it had been retreated, it would have been just a little bit too late. Now, the pioneers are being sort of repositioned back to help out with this. However, the situation is a little bit out of hand and should definitely result in a German retreat from the left side of the map. Now, there is a Grenadier squad coming in to assist, and one of the mortars is up to bed 1. However, the mortar is going to be forced to retreat, and the Pioneers actually sacrificing themselves to get the machine gun. Definitely a good decision, as a machine gun in the hands of the Penals would have been devastating thanks to the 6-man Soviet crews and the fact that the MG42 is so very dangerous. Having a 6-man MG42 is basically impossible to deal with in the early game for the Germans unless he were to use his mortars to great effect. Now, on the right side of the map, the Germans have still managed to capture a lot of territory, and so they're going to be sort of in an advantageous position in terms of map control. And these Penals should definitely retreat as quickly as possible. However, they will have to walk through red cover with a Grenadier squad shooting at them, so they will be very lucky to actually escape because that Grenadier squad was definitely close to wiping that Penal. And that would have been a really bad thing for Rizitas because right now he definitely needs to conserve as much manpower as possible because the defensive doctrine is very manpower intensive, as all of its actually nice wipe on a Volksgrenadiers in the center from JRDN. Now, The defensive tactics are very manpower sort of focused, because there's both the Dashaka and the 120mm mortar, but then there's also the M42 45mm anti-tank gun, and they all come sort of available at the same CPs. So you're gonna have to choose at the beginning which ones to get and which ones to skip. Now, the M42 is definitely the one that's least appreciated of these units, but it is one of the sort of wild cards of the Soviets in some of the weirder commanders, like defensive tactics and the urban defense, because it is pretty effective against light vehicles, such as perhaps a German Tier 3. However, OKW Tier 3. However, Vlosu has gone for the Tier 2 Battle Group Headquarters, and he will go for a support gun, which is definitely going to be good against the sort of less aggressive playstyle that the Soviets have when this tree is selected. Of course, we do have another wipe again, so Vlosu should definitely work on his unit preservation. Of course, at the same time, JRDN is being pushed back to the base by the Kubuwagen. The Kubuwagen will actually do a lot of damage with its MG34 against the ambulance. Ambulance might actually go down, and the Kubuwagen, I feel like, could have just stayed there for the killing blow. I think that was a mistake to actually run away. Now, machine gun, again, going to be flanked by the Penals. Should definitely post perhaps a unit out here in this building to just stop these Penals and perhaps guard the flank. But at the same time, at this point, it's a little bit too late, so the Soviet player is going to be able to just swamp through the left side of the map, just completely annihilating all of the German weapon teams, as always, and that's going to be a real big problem for the Germans. Very lucky, actually, that this watchtower wasn't destroyed by that rifle grenade. If it had been destroyed, then that flamethrower upgraded Penal would have actually died, taken with a veterancy and a 60 munitions upgrade. So that would have been a very bad thing. Of course, it might die anyway, because it's going to retreat with only one man a little bit too late, and also walking for the right cover, once again being saved by partially luck and partially the fact that this one other grenadier squad was in much the same sort of peril, and so had to retreat as well to avoid being wiped by this time by the other Penal battalion. This Penal is definitely going to lose the fight against the grenadiers, despite the fact that the grenadiers have gone up a little bit too far, and I've actually strayed a little bit into red cover, which is not that good. However, there is a 222 on the way, and the MG42 light machine gun is definitely... No, don't do that! Okay, I thought he was actually going to grab the MG42, and that would have been a terrible decision with the squad being upgraded with an MG42, because that would have lost the LMG, and that's definitely not worth it. Now, Dushka is on the field for Eresitas, and he's going to have the armor-piercing rounds actually equipped, which aren't that good, but against such a light armored vehicle such as the 222, even the standard rounds of the Dashaka do a fair amount of damage to this scout car. Of course, with the armor-piercing rounds, it's even more. And since he didn't retreat, it was obviously just a very easy kill for the Dashaka. The Dashaka, obviously having one of the best... Saucy, okay. I think they think that means suck. Of course, dick. oh my god, the banter. I think they think he's Russian, but I don't know. Now, some riflemen actually in the center are going to be pretty good against these unupgraded and unvetted Volksgrenadiers. Now, some SDG upgrades are actually on their way, and the lieutenant actually taking a lot of damage. He's going to have to be retreated just by JRDN, and that's not exactly that good. However, the engagement will go to the Americans, and the Americans will be able to capture the central VP. We do have a... Ooh, mass retreat. Okay. I feel like JRDN could have just left these two full HP squads to their sort of devices over here and just captured the point. He should definitely grab some of his, especially rear echelons, and send them to the right side of the map to just capture points. At this point, there's nothing to defend this area, and there's been nothing to defend the area for a couple of minutes. So I feel like if he would have gone and captured that area instead of just sending all of his infantry units to the sort of meat grinder in the center, I feel like he would have had a much better position in terms of resources, because as you can see right now, the Germans have an advantage in terms of both fuel income, but especially munitions income, because they have the control of both points and a majority of the strategic points. So they just have so many more munitions than their counterparts, and that's going to help them out in the long run, because it's going to allow, as you can see, their grenadiers, for example, to always have upgrades, and then they're also going to be able to have some things like flamethrower on the 251 half track, and perhaps for the OKW, a lot of mines and some panzer tracks on his stern piles. If he does decide to get multiple stern pioneer squad, that's gonna be really good. Now, we may have a double satchel charge, but he doesn't have Eresitas doesn't have the munitions for a double satchel charge. He's only got enough munitions for one satchel charge round. He will try probably to satchel charge this blob. However, it's going to be really hard actually hitting the blob. But it doesn't look like Losu will actually decide to dodge quick enough, and he will actually take a few losses and a lot of damage dealt on the Battlegroup headquarters. And also all of the medics except this one, well, actually these two guys who are on the other side, will die. So thus decreasing the effectiveness of the Battlegroup headquarters, which is pretty damn something that's usually not really taken into account. The fact that these medics in the Battlegroup headquarters are actually models that one can target, shoot, and like kill with explosives. So that's not something that a lot of people do, but remember, when you kill them, the healing speed is decreased because, of course, there's less people to actually go around and do the magical touch on the actual squads. Now, finally, I can talk about JR Dan's doctrine selection. We're talking about fun commanders with defensive tactics, and a fun commander indeed for the Americans as well. We do have Recon Support Company. Recon Support Company, this Venal needs to run away as quickly as possible. Recon Support Company is not a commander that is used a lot. Its main feature is the M8 Greyhound, which has the canister shot, which is not exactly as powerful as it used to be. It used to be just insane, and if you remember the time pre-nerf of the pre-nerf canister shot, then you know exactly what I'm talking about. However, it's still a pretty decent anti-infantry, anti-blob little instrument. Sometimes it wipes, sometimes it just deals a lot of casualties, but it's still pretty good. And of course, the M8 Greyhound has the same exact gun, main gun, as the Stuart, which means that essentially it can basically function like a sort of light Stuart. And the Stuart, right now, it's pretty damn powerful in terms of its space in the meta, because generally light vehicles are very effective against infantry, and they get a lot of wipes with their mobility, their ability to chase squads, their ability to counter harass on the flanks, their ability to just in general kill infantry. So the M8 Greyhound is actually a very dangerous vehicle. If you can let it if you manage to let it just run amok, it's going to be very effective. Now, there's two actual M42 anti-tank guns for the Soviet player. However, at this point, they're not going to be that effective because the German light vehicles were actually being kept in reserve with a pretty good move by Aha, because essentially he saw that the AT guns were there, so he kept his vehicles a little bit back. But right now, he's actually going to lose his armored car because he kept it at the maximum range of this anti-tank gun, as you can see. And that's not exactly the best thing. Also, there was a Deshka with armor-piercing rounds equipped, so that was also very bad to leave a 222 Scott car in at the mercy of that very powerful machine gun. And of course, only the 251 half-track with the flamethrower upgrade is left for the Germans right now as a light vehicle. Now, on the right side of the map, GRDN is block capping on the right side. I feel like this is a bit of a mistake. He could have just left his three-man rifleman squad capturing this point, while all of his other squads would actually be attacking towards the Battlegroup headquarters. Of course, not with the intention to destroy the Battlegroup headquarters, but just to cause a lot of casualties on the German squads, because these Germans are still very low-tech. They've only got the SDG upgrade and no veterancy. And of course, they also don't have any Obersoldaten squads nor machine guns. So I feel like for a long time, the American squads will be superior to the Germans, partially because of their own mistakes and not getting out those crucial units such as the Obersoldaten, which they could get out thanks to their fuel advantage that they have. They could have the Schur Panzer headquarters tier 4 up by now, and that would have been pretty good instead of getting all these low-tech units that could have helped out a lot. Now, actually, the American squads will lose the engagement, which is very interesting, and the lieutenant might actually go down. He's actually going to go down in the red cover from the Sturmgewehr-equipped Volksgrenadiers. Now, there's also a penal squad coming in to try and do some damage to the Battlegroup headquarters, perhaps with a satchel charge, perhaps catch some retreating squads. However, at this point, I feel like it's going to get wiped if it doesn't retreat quickly enough, and there is an MG-34 that's set up. A lot of damage actually from the satchel charge against the German squads that were not in any kind of way separated. And as you can see, all the medics are dead. So at this point, no healing because they're all crawling on the ground. They can't fully heal. And so, yeah, that's exactly what I'm talking about. Essentially, the main reason why you'd get a Battlegroup headquarters so close to the front lines is now nullified thanks to the fact that the satchel charges killed the medics. Now, on the right side of the map, looks like the Stuart is going to deal a little bit of damage to this Folks are your squad. Folks are your are actually going to retreat, if not just exposing them to a lot of damage from the Steward. The Greyhound. However, the Greyhound will decide to sort of charge the other Folks are your squad that's trying to capture the munitions points once again. But the rear echelons will be able to stop them quickly enough. And also the Panzerfaust is not being thrown or either shot by the Volksturniers, which is definitely a mistake. I feel like this Greyhound could have also chased the Folks just to deal a little bit more damage to them on retreat, especially when they entered the red cover. The machine gun on it could have dealt a lot of damage as well on the retreat. Now, there is an M250 cal machine gun in the center from the American player, which is definitely a good decision to keep the central VP under the Allied control. The Allies have had the VP control for most of this game because the Germans were definitely focusing on the right side of the map with their efforts, and that has sort of left them open in the center and left. However, it does look like the machine gun will be forced to retreat by the nice usage of the support gun. Support gun up to 14 kills, which is definitely a good thing for the German players because they need some kind of artillery to dislodge the plentiful Allied support teams such as these AT guns and the Dashka and the 50 cal. Now, JRDN with the recon support company doesn't really have access to a lot of late game sort of armor options. So I feel like he should definitely go for a major as quickly as possible. And he does have the resources for a major. So at this point, I feel like the major would be the best decision for him. Now, we do have a T-70 from Arisitas, which was just kind of hanging around the right side of the map. But right now, it's managed to actually charge this machine gun from the flank. That's dealing a lot of damage, along with the Greyhound. However, there's two Panzerschreck squads coming in, and this is probably going to be the end of the poor Greyhound. Panzerschrecks, of course, being very effective against all Allied light vehicles. So really good play with the Panzerschrecks to actually approach the damaged engine Greyhound, which was finally Panzerfausted by a Volksgrenadier squad after all this time, where it was essentially left to its own devices, left in any kind of way that they could have stopped them. They just didn't even take it. Now, the American Blob will be very effective against the German infantry. However, there is a machine gun on the field for Vlosu, and also AHA does have the Flame Half Track, which is going to be very effective against the Blob, unless the Blob can get some kind of defense against the vehicles, such as these bazookas. Of course, the bazookas will be very good. The one rear echelon squad, which is in the Blob right now, has two bazookas equipped, and it's Vet 2, which means that as soon as it reaches Vet 3, thanks to the sort of quick veterancy rate, at least, veterancy gain of units equipped with anti-tank weapons, thanks to its sort of increased veterancy rate, because shooting vehicles just gives a lot more veterancy, it may reach Vet 3 soon enough and get the fifth man, which is going to be really good. However, it doesn't look like it will be needed, because the Flame Panther just kind of charges in and gets a pretty huge beating from the T-70, along with the Dashka, and the American squads are able to retreat fairly sort of safely. Now, pretty good play by Arisitas, just being all over the map and capturing points on the right side, the center, and the left, and also defending them as well, thanks to this T-70. He has just a lot of mobility all around the map that can be used. Now, unfortunately, this is a bit of a mistake. Charging with the T-70 is not exactly the best decision, because as you can see, there is a pack AT gun, and it's not positioned in the best possible way. It's being repositioned only now. But again, as you can see, partially because of Panzerschrecks, partially because of mines, and partially because of AT guns, it is very risky to send on your AT, rather, your light vehicle after a certain sort of timestamp, such as 10 minutes. It's very dangerous to actually send your light vehicles on a suicide mission like that. So you should not do that at all. Now, we do have a T-34 being purchased by Arisitas, but I feel like this is a bit of a mistake. I feel like the Katyusha right now would be the much better choice for the Soviet player, because the Katyusha would allow him to deal a lot of damage to these sort of camping German units. For example, this machine gun and these mortars and the pack gun, and on the right side, the support gun. Thus sort of allowing the Allies to have a little bit of extra artillery support, which right now they're lacking. They don't really have any artillery, whereas the Germans have a couple of light artillery pieces, as actually one squad of Volksrangers will go down, but the Penal could have been saved there. That's very unfortunate that Vet 2 Penal had to die, and that sort of what was a Soviet success, just wiping the Volksrangers, just kind of turned into a failure. Now, wow. Holy hell, that is incredible. What the fuck? Now, the airborne assault, oh my god, the T-34 actually just comes in and runs over the Fallschirmjägers as they close the distance and actually just jump down with their parachutes, and they're gonna be wiped. Now, what just happened there is Losu used the airborne assault from the Forschermjager Luftwaffe ground forces doctrine to attack this fuel cache as it was being actually placed down. And what that did was it killed the rear echelons who were building the fuel cache, because essentially when units build, they take a lot more damage from any kind of source. So what normally a strike that normally just as the T-34 just kind of suicides against the pack, a strike that normally just kind of suppresses infantry was actually able to completely annihilate two squads in a matter of seconds, which was not exactly the best thing because all those squads were equipped with bazookas, and so that was a lot of munitions that the Allies lost on that trade. But at the same time, there was a lot of munitions lost for the Germans as well. The fuel cache hasn't been completely destroyed, so if there is a new rear echelon squad purchased, in fact, there's two new rear echelon squads purchased from JRDN, he can definitely go in and finish the fuel cache so that he didn't even lose that much manpower. Rear echelons are a pretty cheap unit, only 200, I believe, in terms of cost. So that was 400 manpower, which is quite a lot. However, if he can scrounge up the munitions was definitely the biggest loss there. Now, right now, I feel like the Allies are definitely lacking in terms of both tanks, anti-tank, and also artillery as well. So right now, if the Germans were able to get out a heavy vehicle, or perhaps even just sort of hunker down a lot on a couple of victory points, such as, for example, with this Schürpanzer headquarters, it's going to be really good for them because the Allies are going to lack the tools in order to just dislodge them. Now, again, these penals are being left in the fights a little bit too long. They're definitely going to be taking a lot of losses and a lot of wipes if Elristas doesn't really care for his units a little bit more in terms of just retreating them earlier, because they keep just going into fights when they're very low on HP. Now, his T-34 is being repaired right now, and he has actually gone for a Katyusha at this point, which is definitely the correct decision. At this point, I feel like the correct target for the Katyusha would be this area. If he can destroy this building and also deal a lot of damage to the mortars, then he can make probably some kind of push happen with the T-34s just to destroy the bunkers, and then he can move up with his infantry to sort of screen against the pack and do a little bit of a diversionary attack there, while his ally perhaps attacks in the center. Now, unfortunately, that would be a bit of a hard thing to do for JRDN, because there is a Schürpanzer quarters. The only counter to the Schürpanzer quarters right now for the Allies is this Jackson. The Jackson can be positioned at long range, and at long range it's going to deal a lot of damage to the Schürpanzer quarters. However, it's going to take a long time to kill it because it's a very slow rate of fire unit. So at this point, the T-70 being very close to death, very lucky that the Panzerschrecks miss. Of course, also nice sort of running away in a terrain that was pretty pretty weird for the Panzerschrecks to shoot at. One of them hit the sort of little rise in this road, which is a bit of a shame for the Storm Pioneers. Now, we do have another Dashka being called in by Aristas. Aristas having his cutoff point being capped from him means that the Allies are going to be in a pretty shitty situation in terms of resources, especially fuel right now. They definitely need a little bit more of that. And I feel like this little sort of harassment push on the right side of the map is going to be very crucial for that, because the Germans may send something over there which will sort of weaken them in the center. Unfortunately for the Soviets, the T-34 is going to eat a Panzerfaust from this Grenadier squad, and also eat a lot of Panzerschreck shots from the Panzer Grenadiers, which is not exactly going to be too great for them. However, T-34 sort of survives with just a sliver of health, which is really good for it. And also VET 1 means that it, along with the T-70 over here, can use the secure mode and use that to cap, which is going to be really good for him. Now, on the right side of the map, we do have a little bit of a counter push from the Germans, which is exactly what I was talking about. Just a couple of Soviet squads were able to draw in four German squads, which is a pretty good result. Of course, if the Allies had, you know, a lot of units on the left side of the map and the center, that could have just capitalized upon that and just made a push on the center at the same time, that would have been really good. Now, unfortunately, this one penal is going to die. It's going to be a... What? Why would you retreat? I don't understand that retreat. I mean, the Katyusha barrage was only fired now, not earlier. That was a big mistake. He could have wiped out that penal as well. Damn, that's unfortunate. Well, we have a pan for finally from Wolf 88, who has gone for his Panzer quarters in a very lazy fashion. He took a long time to get there, and now that he is there, he's getting out his Panther, and he's going to have enough fuel for a second Panther if he so wishes. And I feel like that would be a pretty decent idea because his ally doesn't really have any heavier hitting armored choices. For example, the Panzer IV command tank that Aha went for from his German mechanized... No, Festung armor. Sorry. From his German Festung armor doctrine is going to be pretty good against infantry. However, if the allies do manage to get out lots of vehicles such as the State 34 and the allied... the American Jackson, if I can click on the Americans, then the Panzer IV command tank is not going to be adequate at all. Now, the Z-70 should definitely be very careful about these Panzerfaust-equipped infantry, but a nice grenade actually going down on the blob is going to deal a huge amount of damage, and they're all very low on HP. If they actually survive, they're going to be very, very lucky. They're all pretty much on one man with no HP, so one squad is going to go down of Fuchsgrenadiers. And looks like the second Fuchsgrenadier is very close to dying. It's gonna die. However, at this point, the Panther will come in to save the Fallschirmjägers. Fallschirmjägers are almost dead, and oh, very, very lucky for the Fallschirmjägers to survive. The T-70 was sacrificed to actually wipe that, but still, that was a pretty good result for the Allies, wiping out two squads, both with Sturmgewehrs. So that's gonna be pretty much like 60 plus 60, so 120 munitions, and how much is it? 250 to get a Fuchsgrenadier, so 500 manpower and 120 munitions for 200 manpower. That is the T-70, I believe, is it 200 manpower? Yes, and 70 fuel, of course. So it was a pretty good trade for the Allies if they, of course, can get sort of a lot of infantry to push on the right side of the map right now when the Germans are a little bit weakened by that. That would be really good. Now, a Satchel Charge will barely miss the Panther. Actually, if the Satchel Charge would have hit the Panther in a little bit of a better way, that would have actually stunned the Panther, I believe, because Satchel Charge, I believe, does have a chance to do that. Now, unfortunately for the Soviet player, he's not really retreating his T-34 as quickly as I would like him to, because even though he's circle-strafing the Panther with a really good maneuver and actually getting in the rear armor, partially because the Panther is not really being microed correctly, also thanks to the Jackson coming in from the flank, he's going to be able to do a lot of damage to this Panther. However, at this point, the frontal armor is facing the T-34. T-34 is going to go down from the last shot of the Panther before it goes down, and the Panther is going to survive thanks to the smoke of the destroyed wreckage, burning wreckage of the T-34, and the two Jacksons are not going to be able to chase it down in any kind of way thanks to these, partially to these Panzerschrecks actually covering the Panther, and they're now going to go and repair that tank. So that was very unfortunate. Again, pretty good play by Ericitas and terrible micro on his Panther by Vlosu. However, even in those circumstances, the Panther is just too good of a unit to lose to a T-34 like that in a 1v1. Even if the Jackson was coming in to assist, that was just still a little bit too much for the T-34 to handle. Maybe a couple of T-34s would have definitely won that fight, however... just the difference in terms of cost and cost-effectiveness of those units, was not enough, even with the better unit control. Now, JRDN is just floating a lot, which is a bit of a problem for the Allies, because he's got quite a bit of infantry. However, he could definitely do more with that infantry, especially if he had some upgrades on them. And that's a little bit of a problem, because he doesn't have a lot of resources. However, he's not really trying to get a lot of caches down either, with all of these... resources that he does have. I feel like a cache would be a good decision. Of course, Hamlet is not exactly the best map to get caches, because it's very close distance from one side of the base to the other. From one base to the other. And the points are basically in the middle, so there's not a lot of ground to be covered for something like a tank to come in and just snipe the fuel cache. So you cannot really reliably protect them in any kind of way. But still, it would be a nice decision for the Americans. They decided to actually go for a cache. Now, the Svetry Lieutenant is probably going to go down due to the negative cover. And actually, the German squads started to focus down the American infantry, which is not going to be too good of an idea for them, because some nice grenades are going to come down, and these riflemen are just exactly made for this task to just soak up a lot of damage and go toe-to-toe with these German infantry squads in medium to long range once they do get a lot of upgrades. Now, the SU-85 is going to be pretty good for Ristas. That was definitely a good purchase. His T-34 dying means that at this point, due to the fact that the Germans have Panthers on the field, it's not going to be too effective to get a T34 anymore. So the SU85 is going to be excellent, especially because this map is very open. So it allows for a lot of usage of that focus sight and also that long range of the SU85. Just to deal a lot of damage to both structures and vehicles. Now, there is a pack on the field for Ahat, but Ahat is going to have a little bit of trouble using that pack correctly because he hasn't really pushed it up ever to use it. So it's still Vet Zero with no experience. So even if he does start to use it, he's not going to have the crucial target weak point ability, which is going to be very important for him to stun allied vehicles and destroy them. But still, if he can sort of manage to stall the Soviet player and allow his OKW friend, who is doing fairly well on the right side of the map, to sort of continue shining like this, which is not exactly what I had in mind, aka just charging a spam for against a huge amount of anti-tank, aka two Jacksons and some rear echelons of bazookas. Still, it's pretty much still enough for the Germans to hold two VPs, and if Ha can occupy Elricitas on the left side for a long time, and JRDN still sort of struggles against Vlosu, then it's going to be really good for the Germans. However, at this point, I feel like the Allies should definitely sort of group up and make an assault in the center, because at this point they have a lot of tank destroyers. They have two Jacksons and a SU-85, so they can use the SU-85's focus sight ability to have a sort of scouting unit, and that's going to be really good for the Jacksons, because the Jacksons like the ability to sort of scout for themselves. So having that plus the Jacksons in the back is going to be really good to take out the Sher Panzer Corps, especially if the artillery is used in this way to actually assist. So that's going to be nice for the Allies. Of course, there is a MG-34 machine gun in the center, but they can use their flanking maneuvers from the south with a penal, or perhaps even just their Katyusha, or as JRDN is doing, smoke grenades, to sort of avoid the suppression fire of that unit. Very deadly. Nice that the Allies are actually avoiding it. Sorry for the bit of lag. Now, again, the SU-85 should definitely be put on focus sight, and that's going to be good if they decide to do that. Unfortunately, it's actually pushed up a little bit too far, in my opinion. However, a nice grenade from the American infantry squads are going to deal a lot of damage to the Germans, pushing up through the smoke. However, their machine gun at this point doesn't really have any obstructions to its line of sight thanks to the smoke just fading away. So the penal battalions that are pushing up are going to be actually just focused down by the Sher Panzer Quarters. Sher Panzer Quarters actually going to wipe out one of the penals. However, at this point, the SU-85 is doing a lot of damage to this Sher, so it's going to go down pretty quickly. And that's going to be really good for the Allies, because it's going to open up a lot of options for flanking the center. And it's also going to sort of decrease the amount of unit variety that Vlosu can get out, because of course he doesn't have the tier 4 to get out his units. Now, the Panther is on the field, and it's going to try to finish off this SU-85, which is taking a lot of unnecessary damage because of not using focus sight and just charging into range of the Sher Panzer Quarters to deal with damage. However, very lucky for the Panther, a nice ambush from JRDN is not going to penetrate any of its shots just in the first volley, which is going to make the Panther a lot more sort of sturdy in the ambush. Now, unfortunately for the Allies, also a very nice usage of the Satchel Charge from Elricitas is not going to wipe out one of the... wow, that's very unfortunate. It's not going to wipe out one of the Storm Pioneers. Very, very bad play. Just charging up with the SU-85 was not the best decision at all, because essentially it was just so low on HP, and without prioritized vehicles on, it revealed itself a little bit too early by shooting on the German infantry squads, which allowed the Panther to use its range, which is not normally powerful enough sort of to counter the SU-85's range, because the SU-85 has an excellent range in terms of a tank destroyer. Still, it would not have been enough in a normal circumstance. However, the SU-85 was not aware of the Panther's presence. It did not have the Panther in its line of sight, so the Panther could easily shoot with impunity and destroy the SU-85 in one shot. Now, on the left side of the map, the Germans do have control of the left side of the map, and I feel like the Germans are going to have this in the bag if they keep this triple cap going for a little bit more. They have pretty much 3.5 minutes to go. Well, a little bit less, actually, 3.25 minutes of a minute to go before they can claim victory thanks to just VP lead. Now, we do have the Katyusha, which is up to Fed 1, 11 kills. Perhaps actually shooting at the battlegroup headquarters, so it's not going to hit anything, unfortunately, for it. And that's going to be a problem, or maybe I should say her, because it's still Katyusha. Yeah, I probably should say her for with Katyushas. I don't know. I don't know why anyone says it with the Katyusha. It's a her. Well, jokes aside, now, still, the Katyusha was a nice pick and a nice purchase for Aristas. However, at this point, partially because JRDN is still sort of floating a whole bunch of resources, and because the Allies are just being outproduced with vehicles, because the Germans have had the seal control for most of the game, and also the munitions control for most of the game, which allowed them to get a lot of anti-tank upgrades on their infantry, such as these two Panzerschreck upgraded Panzer Grenadiers, which is 240 munitions, and also these 90 munitions, is it 90? Yeah, 90 munitions combat package, Storm Pioneers. Because of this, they will be essentially able to have the armored superiority always, and finally Ha has gone for the tier 4. Wait, what? Oh, okay, right, he never had a tier 3. So finally he's gone for the tier 4 with the Panther, and he's going to be able to destroy this H-285 if the H-285 cannot run away quickly enough. Now, at this point, I'm not really sure what the Allies could do to stop this sort of bleed. Finally, Aristas is back to his old antics and actually capturing with harassment maneuvers on the right side of the map, which is good because there were no German squads on the right side of the AP, so that was a really good play to actually send the penals over there to destroy anything that was defending the area and also capture the point, which stopped the triple capture a little bit. Now, this Jackson is being chased, and it's actually got its rear armor facing the Panther. However, there's not really any danger to doing that because the frontal armor of the Jackson is so bad that I think it's not even possible for a Panther to bounce from it. So even if you are retreating with rear armor facing, it doesn't really make a difference for the Jackson. So actually, it's actually maybe probably a better idea to retreat with the rear armor on, because it may actually just be faster. May actually just be faster and disallow it to retreat in some circumstances. So that would be a quite interesting way to think about things, and it should definitely be tested. I will do some tests on that one. Should it be better to retreat the Jackson just by running with its ass facing the enemy? That would be quite cool. Now, three Forschermeer squads are going to be able to clear out the Allied units on the right side of the map, and unfortunately that was a really bad shot with the Katyusha. That was actually a Creeping Mirage from the Katyusha. That's very interesting. The Creeping Mirage was done in this sort of a way? Yeah, it looks like this way. Eh, I feel like the Creeping Mirage is not exactly that useful after its nerf. In case you weren't playing when the Creeping Mirage was first introduced, which was a few patches ago, a few months ago, the Creeping Mirage used to be really, really accurate, which made it really good against buildings, really good against sort of support weapons, but then they decided to nerf it, and I'm really not sure why, honestly. I feel like that was a really bad decision to nerf the Creeping Mirage of the Katyusha, because it essentially made its Ved 1 a little bit useless, which it's not exactly that good in an artillery unit. It makes it really, really weak. Now, what the fuck? Is that a railway artillery? Okay. Railway artillery. And for now, this Sherman hasn't really done anything. It's just... it's bugged! Oh, I feel like it's bugged. Oh, that's so bad, because why else would it be shooting over here? I feel like he's trying to terraform the area so that he can... yep, he... wow, that is so unlucky. Oh, that's why the... yeah, see, because the replay was called the saddest Sherman ever. And now I know why. Okay, that's a little bit unfortunate for JRDN. I feel so bad for him right now. See, again, I feel like the Sherman was not exactly the best decision. However, it would have done a lot of damage against these blobs of German infantry. And I'll actually speed it up because, unfortunately, it's going to be over by... it's going to be over in a little bit right now. And Aristas is going to be replaced by AI, unfortunately. And did it die? Or was, yeah, that was the Jackson. Well, that's very unfortunate. So what could the Allies have done to sort of bring this back from the horrible situation they were in? Now, definitely JRDN could have used this manpower a little bit more aggressively, and I feel like the lack of INR partisans artisans? Pathfinders. I can't speak. I feel like the lack of iron or pathfinders was a really bad mistake for him. It is one of the main selling points, in fact, in my opinion, the main selling point of the recon support, because the artillery strike from the INR Pathfinders is really, really good at taking out OKW trucks. It is pretty much just the orbital bombardment that does a lot of damage, focused in a very narrow area. It almost never misses, however, it takes quite a bit of time to actually reach the area. It's a bit like a time on target, except probably a little bit better. And it's definitely pretty good. He could have also gone for an airdrop combat group with the amount of manpower that he had, and that would have been really good, because for some reason JRDN decided to not go with a captain after a while. I feel like a captain would have helped him out, but in absence of a captain, he could have gotten an AT gun thanks to the airdrop combat group, and I feel like AT guns would have been really, really effective against the Germans, because think about it, there were two Panthers on the right side of the map from Vlosu, and on the left side of the map there was one Panther right at the end, but only Panzer IV command tank and light vehicles. So actually the 57mm AT guns would have been really effective, because yes, the Panthers have really good armor against the 57mm shots, however, the Panther is not exactly the best anti-infantry vehicle, so it doesn't really have the firepower to actually just wipe out the AT gun in one shot. So it would have been not in any kind of way effective against the AT gun. And so JRDN could have used a couple of 57mm to pretty much great effect. Now, also, I feel like he should have focused a little bit more on keeping the right side of the map under his control. He did make a couple of forays onto the right side of the map with a lot of infantry. However, he never really sent out like lone squads in any capacity, for example, these rear echelons. And I feel like if he would have sent just lone squads to cap single points every once in a while, and especially keep this munitions points under control to upgrade his riflemen with BARs, he would have had a lot more success against the German infantry and, in general, a lot more VPs to work with, because that was the main reason why the Allies eventually lost, because they were a little bit just pressured to charge the center and charge the right side of the map thanks to their VP deficits. So I feel like that could have been done a little bit better for the Allies. Now, for Elevisitas doctrine selection, as much as it's fun to use defensive doctrine, and it could have worked, and it did a little bit work with the Deshikaz, you could have gone for the Deshikaz even just with Lend-Lease, and would have had a lot more options in terms of flexibility, because this commander is not very flexible. It unlocks everything it's got at 2 CPs, and after that doesn't really have anything going for it, perhaps, so I feel like that was a mistake. Also, the Katyusha was used sometimes well, sometimes questionably, so he could have used the Katyusha better as well. Other than that, the usage of the Su-85 was also questionable, with pretty much a lot of lacking the focus sight, lacking sort of the good knowledge of when to send it in and when to retreat, and also the good knowledge of the range of the Su-85, because it could have shot at the Schurpanzer quarters, which was over here, from up to about here, thus being out of range of it, and not taking all the damage that it ended up taking. So, again, a couple of things to work on. However, very nice game overall from both sides. So I want to thank you all for watching. I hope you've enjoyed the game. I hope you learned something from it, and I'll see you soon. Bye.